Breathing deep increases oxygen to your system, right, to the working muscles. No, that is wrong. That is a complete misconception. In this video, I will explain you why that is wrong, and I will tell you what you can do instead to increase oxygen to the working muscles, to your tissues, for optimal sports performance. And at the end of the video, I will tell you how to breathe during exercise. What is up, guys? My name is Gert Leroy. I'm a freediving instructor. I'm a former national record holder, and for the last 8 years of my life, I have been experimenting with and discussing breathing and breath holding techniques with the best freedivers in the world. And all this knowledge that we have gathered in the freediving community about breathing and breath holding, you as a non-freediver can also use for better health and for better sports performance. So deep breathing does not bring more oxygen into your system. It does not oxygenate your body. I don't like the word oxygenation because it is used way too many times on the internet, but it doesn't exist. And why is that? Because we already have an oxygen saturation of 95 to 99% blood oxygen saturation for healthy human beings. So independent of the way you breathe, whether that is deep or shallow or slow or fast, it doesn't matter. You already have 95 to 99% oxygen saturation SpO2. You cannot bring that up any higher. Now, if you would hyperventilate, and hyperventilation means breathing more than you need to, so if you breathe more than normal baseline breathing, then you're hyperventilating. Hyperventilation doesn't necessarily mean that you're having a panic attack. Yes, then you can hyperventilate, of course, but you can also do controlled hyperventilation. When you take deep and rapid breaths, you are breathing in more air than baseline breathing. In freediving, we call this tidal breathing, and that we call hyperventilation. So it looks something like this. That is hyperventilation, but we also have milder forms of hyperventilation, something like... That is also hyperventilation. Anything that is more than normal baseline breathing. So what happens when you hyperventilate and you would put an oximeter on your finger to measure your blood SpO2, your blood oxygen saturation? Yes, momentarily it would go up a little bit. If your SpO2 would be, let's say, 96 and you start hyperventilating, after a couple of minutes, it would go up a little bit to 99%. And that's why people think that when you breathe more, you can oxygenate the body, but that little increase in SpO2 is not considered significant enough to speak of oxygenation. And to understand this even better, we should talk about the Bohr effect now. Now, what is the Bohr effect? It is an effect that describes how the available oxygen in your blood is released to the tissues, to the working muscles in your body. Because it is not enough to have oxygen in the blood, this oxygen has to be released to the working cells. So how does this happen? Now we have to talk about CO2, carbon dioxide. When you have healthy levels of CO2 or even elevated levels of CO2, the hemoglobin, which is the red protein in your red blood cells, lets go of that oxygen molecule more easily to the working muscles. So we need a little bit of higher levels of CO2 to have an optimal release of oxygen that is in the blood to the working cells. So what happens when you hyperventilate? Then CO2 goes down. You're blowing off CO2. You're decreasing the levels of CO2. And when you have decreased levels of CO2, what happens? The hemoglobin holds on to the oxygen molecule. So even though through hyperventilation you would have momentarily a little bit of increase in SpO2, 96 to 99, the hemoglobin will hold on more to that oxygen and thus release it in a less efficient way. In other words, the working muscles, the tissues in your body will receive less oxygen. So, if you would say, if you would argue with me that this oxygenation has got nothing to do with SpO2, but with the way that oxygen is released to the tissues, then I would actually agree with that way of thinking. Then I would say, yes, in that sense, oxygenation indeed makes sense, but it's less oxygenation because of a lesser Bohr effect. A less optimal Bohr effect. When you hyperventilate, CO2 goes down, hemoglobin holds on to the oxygen molecule, so you have less oxygen. So now the big question, how should we breathe to naturally increase oxygenation in our body, if you still want to use that word, oxygenation, it is by maximizing the Bohr effect. And how do you maximize the Bohr effect? By having higher levels of CO2. And how do you have higher levels of CO2? It is by breathing less. So stop hyperventilating. Stop thinking if you breathe deep and fast, you're gonna put more oxygen in your body. You're not. And start breathing less. So what does it mean practically to breathe less? It means tidal breathing. In freediving, we call this tidal breathing or baseline breathing. It is breathing in the most minimal way possible without feeling air hunger. Breathing in the most minimal way possible without feeling like you're not breathing enough. Because if you feel like you're not breathing enough, well, then you are not breathing enough. So you should breathe just enough to sustain breathing over 24 hours a day for the rest of your life, but without feeling air hunger. And this is a constant striving to bring that a little bit down, a constant practicing, because when you're not used to this, you're gonna have to breathe a little bit more to feel good, to feel comfortable about this, than someone who has been doing this for years and someone with good cardio, good endurance, a top athlete. This person with more experience, with more cardio, will automatically, for baseline breathing, breathe less than someone who is inexperienced. So it is a constant striving of bringing that baseline lower. Breathing less, breathing less, breathing less, without feeling air hunger. So that your CO2 levels will be high enough to trigger a maximum Bohr effect. So how are we going to tidal breathe? Through the nose, of course. You can regulate the flux of air way better through the nose than through the mouth. The mouth is for eating, for talking, for doing a bunch of other stuff, but not for breathing. The nose is for breathing. So when you are conscious 24 hours a day, even during your sleep, when you are conscious about breathing through your nose, you're going to automatically breathe less. Now, how can you be conscious about breathing through the nose when you're sleeping? By taping your mouth. So you can look that up, mouth taping. You can put a medical tape over your mouth, and if you wake up in the morning and the tape is still on your mouth, it means you have not been breathing through your mouth. You've been breathing through your nose. Good. But if the tape is off, it means you were mouth breathing, and then you have to fix it. The first couple of nights, it might be a little uncomfortable, but I can guarantee you after a couple of nights, you will get used to it and you will automatically start nose breathing. Okay, I hear you say, okay, Gert, I understand this baseline breathing, tidal breathing, but when I'm doing sports, when I'm exercising and I'm tired, it is impossible for me to even breathe through the nose. I'm breathing like, yeah, totally understandable. Exactly. I know how it is. The thing is that you have to be conscious about is, you know you're breathing through your mouth, that's okay, but you gotta make the switch towards your nose as quick as possible. So when you're doing sports and then you rest in between sets or in between rounds, whatever it is you're doing, then as fast as you can, you switch from mouth breathing towards nose breathing. And then when you're breathing through your nose, the breaths will be still bigger because you need to. Then you're gonna try to calm down the breathing itself. You're gonna go from towards peace in every breath.